Hi everyone. Thank you for joining today's session. My name is Nadia. I'm the Community Engagement and Events Manager for the Reactor in Sydney. I thought I'd just do a little bit of an introduction to the Reactor for those who are not based in Sydney or have never heard of us before and just seen a lot of the content that we've been doing. So the Reactor, we're based in Sydney in the CBD. We are a community hub where you can come and upskill and, you know, get educated on different topics around like Python, data science, AI. We run these workshops. They're between 4 to 6 hours during the week. We've now pushed them virtual, so you'll be able to find them on our actual meetup page. As well as that, we do run a lot of the community meetups in our space as well, such as, you know, Microsoft 365 meetup, SharePoint meetup, Sydney Azure user group, and they come and use our space absolutely free. There's no room fee, there's no setup charges, and you've got a Microsoft host on site as well for any assistance that you may need. So if you want any more information, I'm happy to put my my LinkedIn and my Twitter. You can reach out to me. I mean, even if you're interested in learning what the space is and to potentially use it in future, or if you want to run one of these live streams with us, you don't have to be a Microsoft employee to run a live stream. If you've got some great content that you'd love to share with the community, feel free to reach out. Without further ado, I'm going to hand you over to Cameron, who's going to take you through today's session. Thanks, Cameron.
Thanks a lot for that intro, Nadia. Welcome everyone from wherever you're joining us from. Today's talk is going to be on the Microsoft Graph Toolkit, and I'm going to start this presentation by just having a little walk back in time around the history of Office and how we got to where we are today, because I think that sets the scene for us to be able to position why you would use the Microsoft Graph Toolkit and where it fits in. So Office started in 1990. We got the first version of Microsoft Office. We installed it on a whole bunch of floppy disks. And Office really was business productivity tools, but they were really, the cadence of them was sort of every 3 years, we got a brand new flashy version of Office. It looked different. The whole user interface was different. We got a whole bunch of new features, and we spent the next 3 years learning how to use it, getting the most out of it. And then this new wave of productivity would come. But as the years have gone by and the pervasiveness of the web and the cloud computing is, we really changed the way we looked at acquiring and deploying software. It went from those waves of every 3 years seeing new innovation come through, it moved to Office 365, which was Microsoft Office in the cloud, and those release cycles went from these big 3 yearly waves to much more frequent little ripples of changes and functionality. And we get to where we are today, where we're seeing new bits of functionality and new innovation coming through almost on a daily basis. And you'll also notice what's been happening over the last few months is that Microsoft's been doing a rebranding of Office 365 to fit under a wider family, which is simply called Microsoft 365. And to me, this sort of is a bit of a mindset shift in that if we wanted the productivity tools of Office, we needed more than just Office. We needed the operating system to run it on, which was Windows 10. So we needed the operating system, we needed the device, we needed the productivity tools Office itself. But in the modern world, we also needed security and device management. And that's really what a Microsoft 365 subscription gives us today. The Microsoft 365 subscription gives us the identity up in the cloud, which follows us across all of our devices and all of the services. It gives us those productivity offerings, it gives us the device management, and it gives us the security as well. And one of the reasons I'm explaining those different, fundamental tiers is that underpinning all of that effort in the cloud is where the Microsoft Graph comes into play. The Microsoft Graph is the way that Microsoft stores these different pieces of information and different facets and about us and our devices and the work that we're working on. All of this is held in what's called the Microsoft Graph. I'll pause here for a little definition. The Microsoft Graph is the Microsoft 365 data that describes the patterns of productivity, identity, and security in an organization accessed through a unified API endpoint. Now, it's a pretty long sentence with lots of big words in there, but I just wanted to zone in on two things there. The first bit is that the graph is the Microsoft 365 data. Now, if you think about all of those sort of all the work that you do in the Office productivity tools up there in the Microsoft Cloud, the Microsoft 365 data that's being stored in your tenancy is the things like the documents you're creating, the Word files, the Excel files, things like that. It is also things that you don't traditionally think of as files, such as what's held in your mailbox, all those emails, the calendar entries. That's that type of information. But it's much more than that. It's all the little tiny bits of data in how we interact with people. It's who did we interact with? Who did we collaborate on a document with? What calendars sort of entries have we been invited to? What meetings have we attended? All of these little bits of information about how we interact with other people, how we interact with data, is all held up inside the Microsoft Graph. And it's secure, and some things are only visible to us, some are visible to our organization. Very little, unless we share it, is available outside of our organization. But the Microsoft Graph is the way that Microsoft is storing and maintaining relationships between all of that data and being able to apply sophisticated analytics, insights, and AI on top of that to help us be more productive at the end of the day. Oh, there was one other point I wanted to make before I left that slide, and that was that it's all accessed through a unified API endpoint. So we've got the data held up there in the graph, and the other term that we'll refer to a lot in this session is the Microsoft Graph API. Now, the Graph API is a way for us externally to be able to interact with that data that Microsoft is storing for us up inside of the Microsoft Graph. So the way for us to be able to get access to that data, to be able to see those relationships, and for us to be able to harness that data as well. And the beauty of the Microsoft Graph, and in particular the Graph API, is it's one unified API across all of the workloads. So it doesn't matter if we're trying to get at our email messages or our documents inside of Word or Excel, some stuff in OneDrive, maybe it's just group membership from Azure Active Directory. All of these separate workloads are all available through one API. We authenticate once, and we have one consistent API across all of the different data that's up that Microsoft's storing for us up in the cloud. And that's in comparison to what we would have had if we had all of these services on premises. We would have something like, if we wanted to get at our mail, we'd be communicating using the Exchange API. If we wanted to get at something in Active Directory, it would be a different API. And if we wanted to get at maybe files in SharePoint, we'd be using some SharePoint API. So all of those APIs go away using the Microsoft Graph, and you can get to the same information via one unified API instead. So the Microsoft Graph powers Microsoft products. Now, this is very meaningful to me in two ways. It means that Microsoft, not only is this data that's stored in the Microsoft Graph and this Graph API that's exposed to us as third party, not only have they made it available to us, but Microsoft is actually using this to power its own products. So it means that it's resilient, it's reliable. If it wasn't, Microsoft's own products wouldn't be working. But also, when we look to see, well, what can we achieve using the Microsoft Graph? The examples are all around us inside of the products that we're using on a daily basis. The perfect example of that is inside of Outlook. I'm sure most of you are familiar with addressing an email. As soon as we put our cursor into that to box, you will find that the modern Outlook suggests people that we may want to send this email to. And this isn't a random selection of people. This is based on your interactions, who you send emails, receive emails from. These are the people you're most likely wanting to send an email to, even without you typing a character. If we go further and I actually type in Jeremy, again, I'll get suggestions of Jeremy's, but they're not just random Jeremy's alphabetically within my company or something like that. They are Jeremy's that I am most likely to want to collaborate with, most likely to want to send this email to. And looking at it being that unified API that's available throughout the different products within the stack, we get that exact same experience if we're trying to address an email using Outlook on the phone. Or even if we go to Teams and I try to find a Jeremy, I'm going to get exactly the same suggestions because it's all powered by the Microsoft Graph and that same unified API. Maybe I'm looking for a Jeremy out in Word, trying to add mention him in a comment. Again, it's that same experience, the same people, the same results coming back. So let's look at the Graph API itself. So let's step away from the Graph data and look at the API and how we can make calls to get information out of that graph. And the graph is what we call a people-centric API. People-centric because it puts people at the center at the center of everything. Really, the core of the API starts with me sitting in the middle. You as a user, you authenticate, and you can get to things that are around you, your files, your devices, your tasks, your email messages. And what you can do, and this is, in my mind, this is how I conceptualize this as being a graph, because I can have a look at my files, and some of the attributes on my files might be other people that collaborated on that file. And I can then move across to them, and the graph then centers around them. And if I've got access, I can see, well, what meetings are they going to, and see other people in their meetings. And you end up traversing this graph of data that's all interrelated. So it's a people-centric graph. And that's not just a fluffy marketing term to make you feel like you're at the center of the universe. If we actually have a look at technically how these calls are made when we try to get information from the graph, we're using a URL. It's a RESTful API, which is a style of API, which is very much URLs like you put into a web browser, and you can post information up to those URLs and you get results back. And if we have a look at some examples here, so it's just the first one here, find all events in my calendar. All of these calls all start with graph.microsoft.com. That's where the graph API is located at. And to get events in my calendar, we can just go /me/events. And that will bring back events from my calendar. The next example is creating a folder in my OneDrive, and we can get to that through /me/drive. That's my OneDrive, and then we're into the folder structure of OneDrive. And the last one is trying to find a list of conference rooms in my building. So /me/find rooms list, because it knows what building I'm in, so I can go and find out other rooms that are available within my building. So what sort of data can we get at that's stored up there inside of the graph? Well, there's the super, super popular data sets that you would expect to be there. Mail, conversations, tasks in Planner, users and groups from Azure Active Directory, files in OneDrive, events in your calendar. But what you may not be aware of is, because the graph is being used to power Microsoft's own products, is there's hundreds and hundreds, if not thousands, of data sets that are made available to us through the Graph API. And what's the best way of finding out the information that is stored up there in the graph and having a poke around? And that is going to be our first demo, which is a tool called the Graph Explorer. So for that, I'm going to jump out to Edge. And one of the slides towards the end of this, and I'll make the slide deck available, and this is being recorded as well. So all of the resources that I'll be using through the demos, you'll have links to. So don't concern yourself too much about how I got to this page. I'll be providing those links. But this is what we call the Microsoft Graph Explorer. This is a web page that you can go to. It's publicly available. You can go to this web page and you can sign in using an Office 365 tenant or a Microsoft identity that you've got with a Microsoft account behind it. I will say that you can actually do this without logging in as well, and it will allow you to execute all of this without actually having a tenant, and there's a demo tenant that Microsoft uses by default to do that. But at the moment, you can see I'm logged in as Cameron at Camtoso. So this is one of my development tenants. Now, the whole purpose of this website is to allow you to execute sort of commands against that API, that Graph API, and see the results coming back. So if we just do a very simple one, up the top here, if I do /me on the end of it, that was a very simple query that we had in the PowerPoint presentation, and I run that query, we can see the response down at the bottom of this window. And you can see here, it's just giving my name back, my email address, and some other basic information about me. And that's as simple as it is. I've been able to execute a query and see results coming back for the data that Microsoft's storing against me. Down the left-hand side here, we have just some sample queries. So if I was to try and let's get a really simple one, let's go for my mail. So you can see up the top here, when I click on that sample, it goes for /me/messages, it runs the query, and then when it comes back, these are actually all my mailbox, the first five emails sitting in my mailbox. And there's heaps of information about them. You can see there's a subject down here, a preview of the body, a whole heap of information about it. There will actually be, when the first one ends, there will be a second email message down there somewhere. But what I wanted to show you just very quickly up the top here is there's a whole heap of filtering and different attributes and queries we can add on to these as well. So if I was to not try to get everything back here, and I just wanted to bring the subject back on those email messages, you'll find that it's a lot easier for us to read here. Now when the response comes back, I'm just getting an ID property and the subject of each of my email messages. So now you can clearly see that it's just returning emails from my mailbox, and we can just see the subjects coming back. So that's as easy as it is. And you can see on the left-hand side here some of the samples. And this isn't exhaustive by any means. This is just some simple samples of the different workloads. But you can see the different names here: Excel, Groups, Teams, OneDrive. As you can see, it's different workloads across Office and Microsoft 365 that we can get at here. And another one I wanted to point out was just some of the SharePoint things. So here we can enumerate all the lists in the root site collection of our SharePoint site. So if I scroll up to the top there, that's all available under /sites. That gives us access to SharePoint. /root is the root site collection, and /lists is listing out all the lists that exist in our root site collection. So here we have a list called delivery requests. There would be the shared documents library in there as well that every SharePoint site gets by default. So a really powerful way of just seeing what the data is stored up in the graph and how you can extract that information and what's available to you really, really quickly without you having to write any code at all. All right, with that, we're going to jump back to our slides. And now we understand a little bit about where Office has come to in the cloud and what the Graph API exposes for us. We're now in a position to understand where the Graph Toolkit fits into this. So the Graph API was what we were using there on that Graph Explorer. We're executing raw API calls, and we're seeing the responses come back. But what's been around for a few years now is a series of Graph SDKs. So these Graph SDKs target specific languages. So we have an SDK for the .NET language, we have one for Java, we have one for JavaScript, for Python, there's one that now come out for PowerShell. So there's these SDKs that are very language specific. And the purpose of these SDKs is to take care of a lot of the generic plumbing. So let's say you wanted to execute some of those calls that we were just making, such as going off and getting email messages and getting the responses back. If you were to actually code that up for production-ready software, you would have to take care of, one, authentication, like prompting the user to authenticate and log in before you could execute that request. You would have to take care of handling errors in that request that might come back. Maybe there's some internet connectivity sorts of issues. You would need to take care of doing automatic retries. And also the shape of that data that comes back. It comes back as a JSON sort of formatted document, but you would need to sort of load that into some object structures to make sense of the data that comes back. And that's where the Graph SDKs fit in. It's a lot of this generic plumbing work that anyone that would be wanting to write against the Graph API, they find themselves having to do these generic plumbing tasks. So at the end of the day, the result is whatever you could achieve in the Graph API, you're going to be able to achieve using the Graph SDKs with far fewer lines of code, and it's abstracting the functionality and the logic up to a higher level. And then the latest addition to this developer stack is the Graph Toolkit, and that's the subject of the talk today. Now, the Graph Toolkit takes the Graph SDK one level further. It actually builds on top of the Graph SDK, but what the Graph Toolkit is it's they are whole widgets or components of functionality that achieve a purpose. And they include not just sort of making calls to the Graph API, but they actually include the whole UI experience around a component of functionality. So what do I mean by that? Well, let's take a look at three of the components that come in the Microsoft Graph Toolkit. One of those is the login component. And if you were writing sort of any application that was going to do something with the Graph, with the Microsoft Graph API from a user's point of view, then you would probably need to log the user in so that you can have their authentication details to make those calls to the graph. So there is a login component in the toolkit that takes care of all of that for you. That people picker that we saw when we were trying to address an email message, that whole people picker experience, that whole UI around it, is one of the components that's in the toolkit. And we'll have a look at some of the others in a demo at the moment. Now, one of the important things to note here is that these are web components. So they are only going to be useful inside of a web technology stack. So it has to be a web application of some sort, but it is framework agnostic. And what that means is that it doesn't matter what web framework or web technology stack that you are using. So you could just have a vanilla HTML page that you're writing. You could be using plain JavaScript, you could be using TypeScript, or you could be going out to one of the full-blown JavaScript frameworks such as Angular, React, or Vue, something like that. So the Graph Toolkit doesn't mind what technology you're using. As long as it's web-based, you'll be able to use these components. All right, so let's write our very first Graph Toolkit app. So I'm going to jump across to VS Code for that. Now, don't worry if you're not a pro developer. This is the extent of the code. In fact, I'm going to even take a few lines of code out of this as we step through this example. So I'll take these two lines of code out. Let's step through what this is doing. This is a single HTML. Let's start there. Over on the left-hand side here, you're seeing the complete directory structure of what's inside of this project. It is one file, and you are looking at it on the screen, all 10 lines of it. And most of it is just standard HTML, which sort of the first three lines here is just declaring a HTML document, and it's declaring the head of a document. And then we've got the body down here. And the important things to note here is if we want to use the Microsoft Graph Toolkit, we have to load it in. And here I'm just loading it in from a publicly available like JavaScript file is there on the internet. This mgtloader.js, that is the Microsoft Graph Toolkit, and that's loading it into our page so that we can use it. MGT stands for Microsoft Graph Toolkit. We'll see that abbreviation a few times, so when you see it, that's what it means, Microsoft Graph Toolkit. So once we've loaded that in, those components, those web components, are then available for us to use on the page. And they become available to us as elements, much like we'd refer to other elements like head and script and body that you'd be used to in the HTML world. Once we've loaded this script file in, we get a whole heap of these Microsoft Graph Toolkit components available to us to use as HTML elements, just as though they were any other HTML element. And they all start with MGT. So here's the first one, MGT MCL Provider. It's got a client ID in here. Now, this is fundamental for a Microsoft Graph Toolkit application. And what it's doing is it's giving our application an identity. So the one bit I'm not showing you inside of this demonstration is off in Azure Active Directory, I had to complete one form that sits inside of my tenancy, and it's what's called an app registration. So I give my app a name, and I tell it who I am as a publisher. And it gives me, it generates this client ID, which is a unique identity so that when it comes to a permissions point of view, which we'll need permissions for some of these web components to work, such as if I wanted to go and get some information about the tasks I'm working on or the calendar, the events that are in my calendar, the user would get prompted for consent to say, do you consent to this application to go and read some information from your calendar? And in order for it to do that, the user needs to know, well, what is this application? Who owns it? Where does it come from? Before I can consent to it. And that's what this client ID is. It is identifying this application back to something that's been registered in your tenancy. Now, this is totally secure for me to put this client ID here. It's a public ID. This isn't a piece of security. Security is done at a different level. Okay, so once we've got that MCL provider in, we can then start using some of the toolkit components. And the first one I'm going to use here is the MGT login component. So I'll save that. We'll click go live down here. This is just serving it up off my local development machine here. That's going to load that page up. And as you can see, well, there it had a sign in button. It's actually because I'm in the same browser session as I was just logged into. That sign in button has automatically signed me in. And I can see here who I am. It's actually gone to the graph, and that's my photo from the graph. So it's pulled my profile image from the graph. It's pulled my email address from the graph. Let's go through that sign-in experience. If I actually sign out and we go through this again, you can see that full sign-in experience this time. Okay, it signed us out. It's reloaded the page. So that's the web component that we're seeing. That's the login component from the Microsoft Graph Toolkit. If I click sign-in, it's showing us the standard Microsoft sign-in experience. I want to sign in as this user. If I had multi-factor authentication set up, it would take you through that entire flow. It would prompt for consent if you haven't given it. So that whole experience has been done for us. Now, just from a development point of view, if you had to develop that on your own, that worked across all the different browsers, it looked nice and pulled all that information back, you're in for days, weeks of development. And something like security, it's not a simple or trivial thing to actually code up yourself. So there's actually a lot going on that you get for free if you just use that component. And you can see how easy it was to just plop it onto the page. Let's return to our code and go a little bit further. Let's add another component from the toolkit. Let's use the people picker this time. As you can see, it's just as simple as adding an empty element to the page, saying that we want to use that people picker there on the page. If I save that and return to the browser, you'll now see that we've got this box here and it says start typing a name. And I put my cursor in there and it started suggesting people. I want Adele, I start typing Adele, through she comes, great, and we'll take Alex as well. So we've just got a whole people picker experience, type ahead functionality, that AI suggesting who's closest to us or who we work with when we do that type ahead. All of that goodness and functionality that was available to us when we're addressing an email is now available to us as developers, as simple as putting that element on a page. Super, super powerful. All right, last element I wanted to add on this demo was the tasks element or the task web component. If I return to our web page, this one has a lot more functionality. This is actually exposing our tasks from Planner. So this is all the tasks that are currently assigned to me across multiple plans. We can see there's some here from an office fit out plan and some from Project Unicorn. And it's got the status of them. Some are complete, some are outstanding. But this is a fully interactive control. So any changes I make here are actually going back and updating those tasks on the plan. So I can mark some of these as completed. We can change them so they're not completed. We can change who's assigned to them. Maybe I don't want me assigned on this one, or I want Alex to be assigned on it as well. This is actually going back and modifying these tasks on the fly back into the underlying systems. We can actually add new tasks as well. We can sort of give it a name, say what plan it's assigned to. We can set the due dates and assign the people to them as well. So a fully interactive web component, totally built for you, that you can just put on the page as easy as just putting a HTML element in. So really cool stuff. So that's as easy as it is to get up and running with your first Microsoft Graph Toolkit app. A few lines of just standard HTML, no JavaScript at all, and you can start getting components on a page. Right, let's jump back to our PowerPoint presentation. And I just want to highlight some of the other components that are available inside of the toolkit. So we saw the login component, but there's also others around showing people, showing their sort of their person card, giving functionality to directly send them an email or start a chat with them. What else can we do in there? There's a people's picker, there's a teams and channel picker where you can see what teams you're a member of and then the channels within that team. The agenda component allows you to see events off a calendar, the task component we just saw. So at the moment, this is pretty much the extent of the components in the toolkit right at the moment, but it's evolving all the time. It is a relatively new technology that's come through in, it's sort of been the last 12 months or so that we've really seen this technology sort of come out of GA. All right, so the best way to have a play with these components and what they're capable of is what we call the Graph Toolkit Playground. And this is a website very similar to the Graph Explorer website that we used in our very first demo. So again, the link to this will be at the end of the slides, but it is a standalone website that's just publicly available that you can get to, as simple as I am here. And it goes through all of the different components. See, on the left-hand side here, we have all of those components that make up the Graph Toolkit. And we can play around with it. There's documentation here as well. So this is the management, the Microsoft Graph Toolkit agenda component. And on the right-hand side here, you see the code that you need to put into your HTML document. And on the right-hand side, you see the result of that. And this is actually live running against a demo tenant. So I'll show you what I mean by it's live in a second. So let's have a look at in this agenda component, we're looking at a calendar, rendering the calendar items. If I go to this get by date example, you'll see there's got a few extra attributes here. against the element. Now, most elements support different attributes for them. And this site is the best place to go to actually read about the different attributes that are available. If I scroll this page up, you'll see here some of the attributes that are available. We can change all of these different attributes, and they will change the behavior of how this component displays itself or the functionality that we get. So if I jump back down to this get by date one, what I'm going to do, I'm going to just remove part of that. Didn't quite grab the whole lot. You'll actually see as I'm modifying this, it's changing it on the left-hand side. So this is like rendering in real time. So this source code is being reflected on the left-hand side. So by default, you can see that it doesn't actually tell us what day these events are for. It's just got times. Now I can see by this we're overriding it. So we're telling it to go and get dates out of my calendar for a specific day, which is a little over a year ago. And we're telling it to get 3 days worth of events. But it's very hard to tell now because we need 3 days worth of events when one day finishes and another day starts. So one of the attributes that is supported by this is a group by day attribute. As soon as we put that in, you can see we've got a Tuesday, then we've got Wednesday, then we've got Thursday. So as I say, and obviously here we can change the date and the range that the events are coming from. So there's attributes here, and we can follow through the documentation. You can have a play around here and see what these different components are capable of and how flexible they are to fit your needs. One of the other ones I'll quickly show you is the people one. This one's pretty cool. This just gives you those little faces of people to show. So you can imagine if you're developing your own application, people are going to be involved in your application in some way. Are they authors of documents? Are they approvers? Are they managers? Are they like they're going to typically an application, especially a collaborative application, is going to involve people in some way, shape or form. It'd be great to be able to get this functionality into your app super, super quickly. And that's exactly what the Graph Toolkit allows for. Now here, it's as simple as putting one of these people web components on your page. And here it's just got a show max. So I imagine I can change the number here and it's going to change it to show just 2 people or 10 people and pull their details through. But that on its own, this is just bringing through people. Again, sort of like when I started using type ahead in sort of an Outlook email. It's just people that I collaborate with, and it's using intelligence to decide which people to bring through. But in an application, you are more typically wanting to show specific users. And here's an example of that where we're actually able to provide user IDs. And here it's providing 3 specific user IDs. And those user IDs are then rendered, and you're getting this nice interactive card where we can call them, we can open up a Teams chat message to them directly from this card. So you get all that functionality out of the box. All you've got to do is include that element in your HTML page. Okay, so let's talk a little bit about using this toolkit and trying to build an application with it. Because one thing I get skeptical of when I see a technology like this is that it promises so much for so little effort. So let's imagine we needed to build an application. We saw the Microsoft Graph Toolkit components and we thought this does exactly what our requirement is today. We can get something up and running really, really quickly. And it almost feels like we're getting it for free. But the downside of that, or where my mind goes to, is that, hold on, there's got to be a catch here. Am I going to get locked in that if the business area that I'm developing this for needs something to look slightly differently? Like, that's great, but does that have to be blue? We really need that to red. Or that's not our corporate font and styling. Or this is great, but that piece of information, when we saw those calendar entries, it wasn't bringing the date back on. It wasn't bringing the actual day of the week back on every entry. And maybe for your requirement, you need the actual day of the week and everything coming back on each of the calendar entries. So as soon as your business requirement changes, you do a phase one of a project and then the business comes back with more requirements, are you going to have to throw it all away and rebuild from scratch? And I just want to take you through some of the things that are built into the Microsoft Graph Toolkit to try to assist with this and there's multiple levels here that are designed in right from the outset of the Graph Toolkit to try and alleviate that problem. The first is custom styling. So in that documentation on that website we were just playing around with, it actually takes you through all the styling classes that the different components use, and they are designed for you to override those. So primary things that you'd be using these for are implementing corporate styling, corporate fonts, colors, all of that is totally designed for you to be able to change. The second one is custom templates. So a template is what is used. So under the covers on your web component, you're putting one HTML element in there. So let's take the agenda component. We're placing one element on there, the MGT agenda element. And it is making calls behind the scenes there. It's going to reach into your calendar, find the entries, and bring them back to the HTML page. When they arrive back to the HTML page, what's really happening is that web component is dynamically punching out templated HTML for each one of the results that comes back from your calendar. And it would be a series of sort of like divs and spans, and it's sort of building the HTML for you as those results come back. And each one of those components is using a default template to stamp it out. And that's what determines what properties of information are being used and what order and how they're displaying. And each of these web components provides the ability for you to specify your own custom template and not use the default template. So that gives a lot of control about how those items are going to be coming back and rendering on the page. So that's really useful thing to have built into the toolkit. And another two things that we've got at our disposal are a component called the MGT get component. I'm going to talk about that specifically in a slide in the next slide, and also this global provider, which I'm going to talk about specifically as well. So let's jump into those. So the first one, MGT get, this is a component very different to any of the other components within the toolkit. And it's different for two reasons. The first is that all of the other components are bound to a specific data set within the Microsoft Graph. So the agenda is bound to your calendar. So the login is bound to your identity. It serves a specific purpose. MGT get isn't bound to any data set within the Microsoft Graph. It's up to you to tell it what data set to bind to, which is super powerful. So what this means is you can get access to any data that is stored inside of the Microsoft Graph, even if a component in the Microsoft Graph toolkit does not exist yet to get to it. One example of that is email messages. We've just been through, I've had that slide before that said all of the components that we've currently got inside of the toolkit. There wasn't one to go and fetch your email messages. But this example that we're seeing on the screen at the moment, would go off and fetch our email messages out of the Microsoft Graph. And the way it does that is on this first line, this resource attribute, this is actually the Microsoft Graph API query that is going to get executed. So right back in our first demo, when I used the Graph Explorer and we had a /me/messages and it brought back email messages, that is exactly what this is doing. And that resource is allowing us to specify any of those queries that we can put into the Microsoft Graph Explorer website, we can put directly inside of this component, and it will take care of going and fetching it for us. And it will take care of all of the passing of my identity, the tokens, the security, the prompting for permissions, handling those transient network errors, all of that's taken care of for us. The other thing it will need, because we're specifying what we want to go off and query, we also have to specify under the scopes here, what is the permission set that a user would need to have consented to go and do that. So if we want to go and read their email messages, the scope is called mail.read. And if the user hasn't consented to that for this application, the Graph Toolkit will take care of prompting the user for that. So it takes care of a lot of the heavy lifting for us. So that is what makes Microsoft, the MGT get web component super, super special, is that it unlocks all of the data that's stored within the Microsoft Graph. The other thing that makes it a special component is that it contains no default template for rendering those results back, for stamping out that HTML that will get repeated and inserted into your web page for every one of the results that comes back. And there's a simple reason for that, because it doesn't know what data set you're querying. You're specifying the data set, so you also have to specify the template because you know what data is going to come back from that request. And so that's what we're seeing in this second part. So the first line is our graph call. The second section, this template data type value, is what's going to get stamped out for every one of those email messages that comes back. And here you can see I'm just putting a div around so we can do some styling. And the subject is the property that comes back on each of the emails. So really all we're going to do here is we're just going to see a heap of divs come out with the subject dynamically injected in them. And there's two other parts to the MGT get element that we can specify. One is a template to use while the data is being fetched, while it's loading. And another one is if any type of error occurs, then we can specify some more HTML here that we want to get output in an error condition. And we can actually show the error message itself back to the user so they have some idea of what went wrong as well. So what that would allow us to do, now in our example, we were simply outputting the subject, which is what we see in bold on each of these. But it would be very easy to also dump out the from property, and this is the body preview, which is just a property on the email as well. So with maybe two more lines of code, you could have this result coming back, and you've just managed to achieve a web component using the toolkit that will return email messages where there wasn't a web component dedicated to that task. But really, really simple to achieve that. So it's a great get out of jail free web component, is how I like to think of it. If one doesn't exist in the toolkit, you can build your own very, very simply by just specifying this is the data I want to get from the toolkit, and this is the template I want to use when the data comes back. Now, the second really handy thing that's going to help in those unlock scenarios is the ability to step back the technology stack. So we had a slide up there earlier where we were saying the abstraction of how we were abstracting complexity as we stepped up from the Graph API to the Graph SDKs, and then the toolkit sat above the Graph SDKs as well. But what I also said was that each of those levels of technology is built on top of the other. And so these providers allow us to step back a level to the actual Graph SDK itself. So what's happening under the covers is that when our web page starts up and we put that MSAL provider on and we do that login, add that login component, is that the Microsoft Graph Toolkit is actually creating a Graph SDK environment, a Graph SDK client and context for us, and that's what it's using to make all of these calls on. And if we need to use that ourselves, we can get a handle on it and use it ourselves. But we don't have to set up that whole environment. It's all already set up for us. And that's what we're seeing on the screen here at the moment. Some of this stuff is just trivial. This is TypeScript code. This is just importing in providers so we can reference them in our code. This is where the code really starts. This providers is giving us access. The provider is giving us access to this underlying Graph SDK client. So we get that providers comes from Microsoft Graph Toolkit. So providers.globalProvider, that gives us a handle on the provider it's using, the Graph Toolkit's using. Here we're just checking if it's got a value. And then we can simply say provider.graph.client. Now this is exactly the same. This is a Microsoft Graph SDK client object. Now typically you would have to create this thing yourself. You would have to handle the authentication around it and creating the context for it. But because the Graph Toolkit has done it for us with a couple of lines of code, we can get a handle on it. And now I could make a me call, just that very basic slash me call. This is how I could do it. I could just call graphclient.api me.get, and I would have the results sitting here in this user details object. So it really allows us to simply, if we need to get out of jail because it's locked us into something, we think, oh, I need to do something that I can't do through a component, then you can step back and the whole power of the Graph SDK is there waiting for you to use. And we're going to do that. And we're going to do that in an app. So I've got an app. We're going to step out to here. Let's close a few things down. In the next 10 minutes, we are going to build an app that actually performs something sort of usable. And I was surprised when I was putting this example together just how quickly we can get something like an actual real functioning app together and happening. Now, this may look like a scary wall of code, but I'm going to step through it line by line. The important thing to realize as we get into this is this is actually an entire application that you could deploy. It would function and actually serve a purpose tomorrow. And I haven't cut any corners with it either. So let's set the scene for what we're going to try and achieve. I'm going to jump out to a web browser. I'm going to go to SharePoint to set the scene of what we're developing here. So here I've got a SharePoint team site. Nothing special going on here. This is just a list inside of SharePoint. I'm in my warehouse site up the site here. I'm in camtoso.sharepoint.com sites, warehouse, and we're in a list called orders. This list has got an order number, status, address, total items, order manifest, and contact name. So at Camtoso, we sell products online. We just sell goods in here. We've got some swimming caps, some boots, some glow sticks. We just sell merchandise. People place their orders online. Those orders flow through into this SharePoint list, and our warehouse workers actually operate off this list. So down on the warehouse floor, we have our pickers. Our pickers are responsible for grabbing one of these orders and physically going around to the shelves, getting the items and putting them into a box. And we want to provide these pickers with a lightweight app that they can carry around with them on a device and simply see the orders that are ready for packing. They can see the items that are ready for packing, and they can just pick them off, put them into the box, and mark that order as being packed. And then that will come back and update SharePoint. And we're going to achieve that whole thing using the Microsoft Graph Toolkit. And we're actually going to use both of our get out of jail free things here, because I wanted to show you how easy they are to use in a very practical sense. All right, so I think that's set the scene. Let's jump back to Visual Studio Code. And again, this application, you are looking at the bulk of the functionality. I do have one CSS file so that we can apply some styling just to make things look a bit simpler, but that is all of this application. There is no other hidden files. There's no smoke and mirrors. This is it. Also, I should point out that the green lines of code are commented out. So as we go through this, I'm going to uncomment those out as I explain different pieces of the application to light up different pieces of functionality. But the green bits at the moment aren't doing anything. So let's walk through from the top. Okay, it's a HTML document. It's got a head. Okay, excellent. Inside of there, we're loading in a script, and that's the Microsoft Graph Toolkit loader. Okay, this is exactly the same as that first application we wrote. Nothing's different. This next line is commented out, so let's not worry about that. And then we've got an MSAIL provider. So this identifies our application from a security standpoint. So the user knows who they are when they start consenting to things. And we've got a login component on our screen. Okay, so down to here, nothing has changed. In fact, I'm actually using the same app ID as what we were in the first example. So there is not one piece of thing that's changed, really. Well, there's not really. There is nothing that's changed. So when I get down to this is the only bit of code left that isn't commented out. And you'll notice that it is just one MGT get element. And what we're going to use this for is to go off and fetch those orders from our SharePoint site and show them on the screen, because our picking app, that's exactly what it's going to need. It's going to need those orders on the page for our picker to see. So let's go and see how we can get those items out of SharePoint and show them on the screen when there isn't even a component inside of the toolkit to do this yet. So the first attribute, as we saw in the PowerPoint presentation, the first thing we need to do is point it at the data set. What information do we want to get out of the Microsoft Graph? And I used the Graph Explorer. I used that website to actually craft this query because you have to get the syntax right. And the easiest way to do it is just log into your tenant where this SharePoint site exists and start playing with that Graph Explorer until you get the response back that you want. And follow through the examples in the documentation. So what we're doing here is we're going to the site's endpoint, and I'm going inside of my tenant. And then it's not the root site that I want to get to, but I want to go to /site/warehouse. That was the site, the warehouse site that our list existed in. Once we've got to the site, I want to go into the list. So I go /lists. This is the ID of that orders list. And so once I'm inside of that orders list, I want to have a look at the items inside of that list. Now that would be enough to get us back all of the items, but let's go a little bit further, because we don't actually want all of the items. We just want the items that are in a particular status, the status that is ready for packing, because if they're not ready for packing yet, as a picker, I don't care about that. They're not ready for me yet. And after I've packed them, well, again, I don't care about them. That box has been packed. So we really just want a query, and that's what this filter does on the end of it. We just want to filter it where the status field is equal to ready for packing. And this expand is a way of saying, well, we want to get all of those different columns of information. By default, the Graph API is very efficient in the payload of the information it sends back to us. So we want to just tell it, hey, we want all of those different columns of information that are being defined on the items in SharePoint. I want them all to come back so that we can display them on screen. So that query is enough for this get component to go off and handle fetching that information for us. The scopes is telling us what permissions we need. So we need the ability to read what the user can read from SharePoint. And that's the scope that we use for it. We're saying to give us two pages of results. And we're also putting a polling rate in here. Now, this is pretty cool that this element supports a polling rate. What this will do is it will re-execute this same query every 5 seconds. And if the results have changed, the data has changed, then it will take care of re-rendering the templates, the data, and binding it to this template. And so it'll keep our list of items that are ready for packing fresh and up to date as new orders come in inside of SharePoint without the user having to refresh the page at all. Okay, so that goes and fetches our data. And then this template is what will get repeated for each of the results that comes back from SharePoint. So for each of our order items, we're just creating a div. I've got this just a div around the outside so I can apply some styling to it called order. And then within that, we've got the order header as a div, the body and the footer. So the header is just going to have the title, which is the order number. It's going to have the contact name of who the order is for. And then in the order body, we have the order manifest, which is just another column inside of SharePoint. And that's just each of the line items that we need to pack. And then in the footer, we're just going to give a count of the total number of items, because that's just an easy reference for the packer as they're going around down there to think, okay, I've pulled those things in off the shelf. I've got four items in the box. I'm supposed to have four items for this order. Done. All right, let's ship it. Okay, and then the templates, the other two templates are the loading templates. I'm just simply outputting the word loading onto the screen while the fetch is happening. And if there's an error, I'm just showing them the actual error message itself on the screen. Okay, so let's save that and see where it leaves us. So it's just hosting off local. We can see we've got our signing component. Really quickly, it said the word loading there. If you're quick, you might have caught it. And now we've got some data coming through onto the screen. And we'll notice we've got sort of order chem001 for Rachel Stevenson. Then this next line is the actual manifest. It's telling us what we should pack in the box and items 5. And then we start the second order. So if we switch back to the warehouse, we'll see here that we had two orders ready for packing. The first one was for Rachel Stevenson, and the second one was for Tom Blue, and this third one is still in a requested state. So it looks like things are working. We've got two orders, they're for the right people. That third order hasn't come in yet. What I'll also do is I'm just going to open the Chrome Inspector over here on the right-hand side. Now, I know that text is probably going to be too small for you to make out coming through this live meeting, but the actual content of it isn't so important. What I wanted to point out is you'll see every 5 seconds that there's more network traffic happening. That's that polling event going out and seeing if those items have changed. So that looks like it's happening in the background. So that looks like it's working as well. So I think everything is functioning as it should be to this point in time. Let's return to the code for a minute, and I'm going to make our first change, and it's a pretty massive one. I'm going to go up here and I'm going to load in a style sheet, which is about 10 lines of CSS to do some styling. I'm not the best style sheet person in the world, that's for sure, but it's enough for us to see those orders a little more clearly. And really, for an application for these packers to go around, you might not need much more than this. This is cross-browser. It will flow around as we get more orders on the screen. As you can see, this is something that a user could log into. They could see the orders that are in the right status. They could walk around with a device, quite easily pick these things off the shelf, verify the right number of items are in there. And the next thing we need to do is we need them to be able to mark these things as packed so we can update the system. We should actually test to make sure this is working. So let's come out here and let's change that last item that's just in a requested state. Let's change that so it's actually ready for packing. Okay, ready for packing. If we're quick enough, we are. There it is, it's come in for us. So we've managed to write this dynamic application that's pulling these items through and keeping them in sync with SharePoint. All right, let's quickly return to code. And let's put this button on here. So we're going to go back and we're going to actually update SharePoint and change that status to let SharePoint know that it's been packed. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to add a button inside of that template. So we're going to add a button to every one of those cards for our different orders. And we're just going to put the text on that button to say it's marked as packed. And we're going to call this function, change status to packed. Now this function doesn't exist. We're going to have to code that up, and that's what we're going to do down the bottom here in a moment. We're going to write some script. But we're going to call that method, and we're going to pass in a handle to the button that they've just clicked on. And this ID it's the ID of the SharePoint item inside of SharePoint. Because we're still in this side of this template, we can use any of the properties off the item that's coming back from SharePoint. So I'm going to pass through its ID because we will need that when we try to make a call to update the item. Okay, so down to our last bit of code that does our magic of the update. And if I uncomment this out, let's talk through what this does. Now, the first line of code is outside of our function because this first line of code will actually execute as the page loads up. And this is going through and using that provider to get a handle on the underlying Graph SDK client. So we're stepping back from the toolkit because there's nothing in the toolkit that's going to have the logic to go back to a specific SharePoint list and update a specific column to a specific value. I mean, that's very unique to the app that we're trying to build. So we're going to step back, and this is as easy as it is to go and get that underlying Graph SDK client that's been set up, initialized, and all the authentication is already handled for us. So we just go to the providers, the global provider, graph.client, and that gives us this Graph SDK client for us. So now inside of that function that's going to happen when the user clicks on the button to say that they've packed that order, we can simply make a call to the Graph client. And again, this is a query that I just formed by using the Graph API Explorer website. We're going to go to that same site, same domain, same site, same list. That's the ID of the list. We're going to go to the items, but this time after items, we go slash item ID. So that's the ID that we pass in. That's the actual ID of the item inside of SharePoint. And we're going to make this call against that item's fields because it's one of the fields we want to update. It's the status field. This next line of code is, this is the Graph SDK taking care of consent for us again, because this time, we need the ability to update items inside of SharePoint on behalf of the user. And that's us saying, well, that's the permission we need. And the Graph SDK will take care of prompting the user for consent if they haven't already granted it. And then finally, what we actually were trying to do is we just simply want to update the status field to be packed. And that's all that's required. The Graph SDK will take care of making sure that update happens for us. And the last thing I wanted to do is that I wanted to give the user some visual feedback once I've actually pressed on that markers packed button, because it'll take a little while for the graph to make that update. Well, it won't actually take it long to make the update, but what it will take a little while to do is that we want that order to actually disappear from the user's device because they've packed the item, they mark it as packed. We don't want it to be on their device any longer. But from the code that we've already written up in here inside of the MGT get, because we're querying just for items in a status of ready for packing, this polling rate will take care of removing the item for us, but it may take up to 5 seconds for that to happen. So what I'm doing here is I'm just getting a handle on the button that the user's clicked on, and I'm changing the class of that button. So that will apply a different styling to it, and it will actually just hide the button. So when the user clicks on the button, it'll hide it, so they get visual confirmation that, oh, the button's worked, it's done something. And then within 5 seconds, we should see that order disappearing. Okay, let's jump back to the web page and have a look at that in action. So we have our items, we're packing an order, we run around, we grab our glow sticks, we grab our mesh glasses, we grab our whistle, and we throw them all into a box. We should have 12 items. Yep, check, we've got 12 items, markers packed. As you can see, the button's hidden itself, and within 5 seconds, the get component's taking care of updating the application for us. If we go back to SharePoint, we should see that this item that was ready for packing, we'll actually have to refresh SharePoint for it to see the change, but we can see that we've updated it now and it's packed. So we've now gone full circle. We have an application here where we can come in at the start of the day and let's have a look. At the start of the day, we could come in here. We would be looking at a device, and I imagine for this type of application, it's probably a shared device that sits down on the warehouse floor. We would come in, you'd put some sort of branding above the top of this so that they know that they've opened up the right web page, but they would sign in. This is fully secured. We've taken no shortcuts here to actually go through and do the login, the consent. As I say, there's multi-factor authentication at play. That would all happen here as well. So we're logging in, we're securely getting access to SharePoint data. It's dynamic SharePoint data in that just with this page open, we can see that new orders coming in, we'll refresh on this page. It's presenting them to us nicely. It's giving us the ability to walk around with this device. When we've packed them, we can mark it as packed and it's updating SharePoint. We've actually developed an entire application in just over 10 minutes and in 40 lines of code. And I think in those 40 lines of code, I've got at least 4 of those lines that are actually just blank lines to break up the different sections. So you can see really how powerful it is by using this Microsoft Graph Toolkit. And in that demo, we actually queried SharePoint and presented SharePoint items, and a component doesn't exist for doing that inside of the Graph Toolkit. And we updated SharePoint, which required us stepping back a level of the to the Graph SDK client as well. So we actually used get out of jail free tools here, and not just simple examples within the toolkit. So hopefully it's very clear why you would use the toolkit. It's going to cut your development time enormously. The components that are in the toolkit, they present beautifully. They work across different devices. And it doesn't matter what technology you're using to develop your web application with, they will work with every framework or no framework at all. In those samples I did today, those demos, I was using no framework at all. Okay, these are my contact details if you would like to get in contact with me. Happy to connect with anyone on LinkedIn. I'm fairly active on Twitter. I have my own blog site. And these are links to all of the different resources that I used in the demos or spoke about today. With that, I'm going to hand back to Nadia, who is going to give us a bit of an overview of upcoming events at the Reactor. And then I'm going to take that time to look through any of the Q&A that's come through and answer a few of those questions. All right. Thanks, Nadia.
Thank you for that, Cameron. That was a really great session. It was really super quick. Okay. So hi, everyone. I'm just going to take you through a couple of the upcoming events that we do have going on at the Reactor. And just also, if you do want to see what else is coming up, follow our meetup page at meetup.com/Microsoft Reactor Sydney. And you can also follow us on Twitter as well to see some of the global events that are happening as well. So tomorrow we actually are running a session called the Unobtrusive Power Platform DevOps Pipeline. And this is going to be run by one of our MVPs, Rami, who's based in Wellington, New Zealand. And he's going to show you what's possible with Azure DevOps and the Power Platform. Following that, on Thursday, we do have a session called How Azure SQL Can Be Your Preferred Database Platform. So for this session, we will actually be joined by the Azure SQL product team from Redmond. So this is going to be a really great one. If you've got some feedback, if you've got a lot of questions, this will be a great session to attend. They're going to walk you through the various options to deploy Azure SQL based on your workload and dive into some features that make it an effective platform. And then next week, we jump into a session on Microsoft 365 adoption success. Now, this is going to be a talk done by Kirsty McGrath, who's an MVP as well. She'll take you through some of her challenges and success stories around Microsoft 365 adoption. And, you know, as someone who's been there and done that, Kirsty is looking forward to making sure that you guys are on the right track. So if you do have any feedback on this session, feel free to go to the links. I'll also post that in the chat as well, and you will need to use the event code 7691. So without further ado, I'm going to hand this one back over to Cameron to answer your questions. Thanks, Cameron.
Awesome. Thanks, Nadia. I appreciate we pretty much are on time at the moment. So I'll just go through a few quick questions and try to answer a few of those. So appreciate everyone for attending and for the questions. It's really, really great. So one question here is, from Data Messy, does Graph SDK ever let devs circumvent target source permissions, e.g. SharePoint list permissions? The Graph SDK won't let you go get any more permissions than what the user would have. So when we're asking for those permission scopes, and the user would see a consent prompt to say, do you let this application, do you consent to this application getting access to XYZ that's asking for, you can never get more permission than what the user themselves has. So in the context of SharePoint, the most you could ever get from an application perspective is what the user already has themselves. that's in the type of application we're creating there in the Microsoft Graph Toolkit. And that's if you're building a web-based application, that's the only model that really works. There is another way though, if we're just talking about the graph in general and the data that Microsoft's holding in the graph, you could create more sort of daemon service type applications where a user is not involved in the process. So if you're doing some sort of analytics where you wanted to I don't know, mine data about what boardrooms are being, or what rooms in your organization are being booked the most and at what times of day and things like that. You would need information across all users' calendars, or maybe only specific pieces of them, but you would need it across all the users. And they're called app level permissions. But as far as the Microsoft Graph Toolkit goes, because the toolkit components are very much user interactive, you would be looking at user permissions. But there does exist, if that's the type of thing that you're after, that's the type of data and the type of use case you want to be doing things without the user present and across different users, then there is something called app level permissions. But for that, it would have to be a tenant administrator that would be granting access for an app to have that level of permissions. So hopefully that answers that question. Andrew has asked, would I publish that HTML page with the demo, please? And thanks for your kind comments about the presentation as well. That demonstration that I just gave about the warehouse, I have written, there's a series of articles. It's the one of the links that was on that that slide, that final slide. There's a series of articles called A Lap Around Microsoft Graph Toolkit, and we're actually halfway through that series at the moment. It's two articles a week talking about the Microsoft Graph Toolkit and getting up to speed with it. I actually wrote the article about the MGT GET component, and the example I used when I wrote that article is I came up with that warehouse example, and that entire sample is in GitHub, and that article walks you through how it works. So if you follow that link that's on that final slide, you can get the full source code for that whole thing. Okay, what else we got? I think we've got probably good time for one more quick one here. What do we got? Is it possible to self-host on-premises the Microsoft Graph? That is simply a no. The Graph is only available, it only exists, the concept of the Graph only exists inside of the Microsoft Cloud. It requires a connection, a live connection to actually make those queries. There's nothing you can really do offline. There's nothing stopping you from taking the data offline and caching it inside of your application, but you can't query the graph, you can't get access to the graph without going through the cloud. Are there any workloads that you could actually connect through? I believe there might be something in there from a mail perspective. So I think if you have a particular version of Exchange, I think it's like 20, you might even need a 2019 Exchange server. I think there's some way that you can connect a gateway, but you still need a tenant up in the cloud. There is some way, I believe, to connect your server. And I think the Microsoft Graph will actually query, and it can connect back to your Exchange server on premises to source the data. But there's very, very limited scenarios. In general, the answer to that is going to be a no. The Graph is online, Microsoft 365 only, and not an on-prem offering. I don't believe it exists with Azure Stack either. So I think it really is just a cloud-only offering. And I think that's all we're going to have time for today. So again, really appreciate you joining the session. I hope you found it valuable. I hope I got you excited about the potential of Microsoft Graph Toolkit and the Microsoft Graph in general. And feel free to connect with me, reach out to me. I'd love to hear what you're doing with this sort of technology. So thanks a lot.
Thanks, everyone, and we'll see you next time. Bye.